Halo semua, good morning and welcome to our podcast. Nama aku Nisrina Syaira Ainia, bisa dipanggil Naya aja. Dan hari ini aku akan membantu jalannya podcast kita. So, today we have two speakers. These are my friends and mereka akan membantu aku untuk ngomongin tentang Perfirium, Lokia, dan Dolores Palsu. I actually didn't know what this is about, but this friend will help me to know more about Perfirium, Lokia, and Fake Dolores. Nah, langsung aja nih kita sapa teman-teman kita. Halo Kusya, halo Niken.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, how are you guys today?
I'm fine, thank you.
Niken, apa kabar nih?
Alhamdulillah, kabar baik.
Oke deh. Nah, sebelum kita mulai nih, ada baiknya kita berkenalan dulu dong. Kalau misalnya kita nggak kenal sama pembicara kita, berarti kita nggak sayang ya. Nah, boleh nih dari Niken mungkin kenalin diri dulu.
Oke. Halo semua, kenalin nama aku Niken Herdianti, biasa dipanggil Niken. Asalnya dari Pati, Jawa Tengah. Terima kasih.
Okay, thank you, Niken. Nah, Kusya, can you introduce yourself?
Hi, my name is Kusya. I'm from Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. And I'm from Batch 55 FKH, same as both of you.
Okay, Kusya so far away from us, yeah, guys. She is in Malaysia right now and actually could be together in FKH. Nah, tapi it's okay because with this Zoom meeting we can make podcast together. Nah, sebelum masuk materi nih, aku sendiri nih sebenarnya masih belum tahu banget tentang apa ini Perfirium, Lokia, dan Fake Dolores. Nah, mungkin sekarang yang pertama kita bakal bahas tentang Perfirium dulu. Nah, apa sih sebenarnya Perfirium itu? Niken boleh kasih tahu aku nggak?
Oke, jadi gini Naya, Perfirium itu masa postpartum di mana masa organ genital kembali ke kondisi fisiologis dan histologis secara normal seperti pada keadaan saat tidak hamil. Perfirium ini biasa disebut dengan masa nifas, seperti itu.
Masa nifas ya, aku pernah dengar deh tentang masa nifas, but Kusya, can you tell me more about this?
Okay, so Perfirium in cattle is classified into three stages. The first stage is early Perfirium, then the second stage is clinical Perfirium, and the third stage is full Perfirium. Clinical Perfirium stays for 21 days during which the uterus returns to normal size, but not normal histological structure. The whole Perfirium lasts about 42 days, during which the uterus regains its normal histological structure as before pregnancy. Depending on the endocrine status of the Perfirium, it's classified into Perfirium period, intermediate period, also known as pre-ovulatory period, and post-ovulatory period.
Oh, wow. Oh, so how does it work?
Well, it's mainly the restoration of the uterus to its normal non-pregnant size and function after parturition is termed uterine involution, which depends on the rate of myometrial contractions, elimination of bacterial infection, and the histological region of the endometrium. Involution is of the uterus is necessarily before the cow can conceive again. As a result of the removal of the fetus, oxytocin and prostaglandin production reduces the uterine size. The reduction in the size of the uterus occurs in decreasing logarithmic scale, the greatest change occurring during the first days after calving. Uterine involution is considered to be complete when both uterine horns have returned to normal or almost non-gravid size in their normal location in the pelvic floor, and their normal tone and consistency. Uterine involution results from three overlapping processes, which is uterine contraction, loss of tissue, and tissue repair.
Oh, so there is so many change that happen in the uterine, right? Okay, so pasti ya, karena abis kita melahirkan, uterus kita kan pasti akan membesar, dan uterus hewan juga pasti akan membesar, dan harus kembali ke bentuk semulanya gitu, setelah nggak ada fetusnya. Nah, tadi kan kita udah banyak ngomongin tentang di uterusnya nih. Nah, kira-kira ada nggak sih peran ovariumnya dalam masa nifas ini?
Peran ovarium di sini tentu sangat penting ya, di mana kembalinya aktivitas ovarium postpartum sangat diperlukan untuk mencapai masa subur normal. Siklus estrus sangat bergantung pada interaksi hipotalamus hipofisis yang berfungsi penuh. Kehamilan akan mengganggu siklus estrus dan interaksi antara hipotalamus, adenohipofisis, dan gonad, karena sekresi steroid plasenta dalam jumlah besar akan memberikan efek umpan balik negatif terus-menerus, sehingga progesteron akan meningkat dan menguras simpanan hipofisis luteinizing hormon pada saat menjelang akhir kebuntingan. Seperti itu.
Jadi memang kalau di ovarium lebih ke bukan saiznya tapi lebih ke hormonalnya gitu ya. Okay, that's so interesting about puerperium. Now, I think it's time for us to talk about the next topic, that is lochia. Nah, aku sendiri juga asing banget nih sama namanya lochia. So, Kusha, can you tell me what is lochia exactly?
Okay, so lochia is a platyfluid that suggests placental separation that can be observed at any point of labor. It is made up of blood, placental tissue, load of endometrial padding and mucus. Lochia is usually ejected from reproductive tract within a few weeks of calving. But if the uterine involution is prolonged, the discharge can last up to 30 days. The color of regular discharges varies from dark brown to red to white, and the amount reduces over 4 to 6 weeks as the uterus involutes. It may come out of the uterus, also known as uterine lochia, or the cervical canal and vaginal canal, which is just called lochia. Uterine lochia is discharged immediately after calving and contains approximately 1,400 to 1,600 ml of fluid. It is initially dark red after 6 to 8 days postpartum. The volume has decreased to 500 to 600 ml, and its character is brown, red, and gelatinous. By 12 to 14 days, it is dark red and almost impossible to measure due to its small volume. Uterine lochia contains no slime. Lochia from the cervical canal and the vagina is initially transparent, thereafter changing character to a more chocolate color discharge. Before ceasing at day 16 postpartum, it has a cherry red color. The total volume is approximately 500 to 2000 ml. Regardless of origin, the lochia should not carry any disagreeable odor. Both uterine lochia and lochia are normal physiological events during the involution and must not be mistaken for pyometra or metritis.
Okay. So why does this lochia is happen?
Okay, so lochia is technically a way to get rid of the extra blood and tissue in the uterus that help the fetus grow. The blood in the lochia comes mostly from the area where the placenta detached itself from the uterine wall during birth, leaving a wound that needs to heal. The endometrial lining, which thickens during pregnancy, also slows off. It's similar to when females have menstruation period.
Okay, so what do we have to expect from this?
Normally, lochia is categorized into 3 postpartum bleeding stages.
Oh, could you tell me these stages?
Okay, so the first stage is normally called lochia rubra. It occurs during the 2nd to 4th day. The bleeding is the heaviest for the first few days. That would be bright red and would be very heavy. It's normal to see clotting during this stage, along with a glow in a quarter or a small part. This is part and parcel of normal postpartum bleeding. Okay, next stage is lochia serosa. about day four, I mean, it occurs during day four and lasts for about 2 minutes. Left flow will light it. Its color will change from red to about a watery pink. The placenta would also still likely be bleeding, but it will be significantly lighter than the first 3 days after giving birth. And then the last stage would be Lochia alba. It occurs during the second to the sixth week postpartum. Lochia changes from pink to a yellowish whitish color. This stage of postpartum bleeding is mostly white blood cells leaving the body after they help heal the uterus after birth. That's about it.
So, do we will see something like menstruation in this Lochia?
Yeah, it's quite similar to menstruation, but it will last a lot longer.
Oh, sure, there is so many stages and a big amount of fluid come out from the uterus, right? Okay. Thank you so much, Kusha, for the information that is kind of new to me. Also, and maybe next we can move to the next topic dan namanya ini adalah Dolores palsu. Nah, aku juga nggak tahu nih apa yang palsu sebenarnya dari Dolores ini. Nah, mungkin Niken boleh nggak sebenarnya kasih tahu ke aku Dolores palsu ini tuh apa sih?
Oke, aku akan menjelaskan tentang Dolores palsu itu. Jadi Dolores palsu itu adalah perjanan yang terjadi pada hewan bunting sebelum fase pengeluaran fetus atau ketika fase persiapan partus belum terjadi. Jadi Dolores palsu itu kayak kontraksi palsu semacamnya, seperti itu.
Kayak mau melahirkan tapi ternyata belum gitu ya, ternyata. Okay. Biasanya kapan nih Dolores palsu ini mulai terlihat?
Untuk Dolores palsu biasanya terjadi ketika 2 minggu sebelum partus. Sebelum melahirkan biasanya 2 minggu baru tuh terjadi Dolores palsu.
Kayak udah-udah kerasa gitu tapi ternyata belum gitu ya. Nah, yeah. Kalau misalnya untuk di hewan sendiri, ada gak kira-kira hewan apa aja yang sering gitu mengalami Dolores palsu ini?
Okay, untuk kejadian Dolores palsu, ini tuh sering terjadi pada sapi dan babi, namun jarang terjadi atau jarang banget dijumpai pada kuda, kayak gitu.
Kenapa tuh bisa terjadi Dolores palsu ini?
Untuk kejadian Dolores palsu biasanya terjadi karena beberapa faktor. Mungkin biasa terjadi karena adanya perubahan temperatur yang drastis. Hewan mengalami kejadian traumatis seperti terpeleset, terjatuh, atau semacamnya. Kemudian adanya gerakan ekspulsi dari fetus itu sendiri. Sama kalau pada babi, biasanya terjadi prolapsus vagina akibat perjanan yang terus-menerus.
Jadi gerakan-gerakan dari fetusnya itu juga bisa bikin induknya itu mengalami ini ya ternyata ya?
Iya.
Dan tentang temperatur juga berarti kayak kalau misalnya temperaturnya siangnya panas atau malamnya dingin kayak gitu, itu bisa mempengaruhi juga ya ternyata.
Iya, lebih rentan terhadap Dolores palsu gitu.
Gitu. Nah, biasanya gejala-gejalanya tuh seperti apa nih, Ken?
Untuk gejala dari Dolores palsu itu sendiri, dari hewan itu mungkin akan mengalami perjanan, namun perjanannya itu tidak kontinu seperti itu. Kemudian, hewan akan mengalami rasa sakit di bagian abdomen seperti saat kolik gitu. Kemudian, kalau pada hewan pemamah biak, dapat disertai dengan prolapsus rekti atau prolapsus vagina. Untuk kuda sendiri, biasanya terjadi dilatasi serviks sebelum waktunya, karena adanya cairan allantois yang menekan kanalis cervicalis. Namun, kalau pada sapi dan babi, tidak pernah terjadi dilatasi serviks sebelum waktunya. Seperti itu.
Jadi emang agak spesial ya di kuda ini, dia agak beda sendiri gitu gejala-gejalanya. Oke, nah kira-kira nih buat kayak mengobati atau mengurangi Dolores palsu ini, kita bisa ngapain ya, bisa kasih terapi apa kira-kira?
Oke, untuk terapinya mungkin dapat melakukan penggunaan obat penenang untuk menghilangkan gejala perjanan. Namun, jika sampai terjadi prolapsus vagina, maka harus direposisi dan dihindarkan dari residiva, seperti itu.
Oh my God, wow, I just know about this. Dan ternyata banyak banget hal-hal yang aku baru tahu kayak tentang si Dolores palsu ini ternyata kayak-kayak mau melahirkan tapi belum ya ternyata. Nah, thank you banget buat Kusya sama buat Niken nih untuk hari ini materinya karena apa? Karena kalimat-kalimat kayak Berberium, Lokia, dan Dolores palsu ini kalau buat awam tuh jarang terdengar, tapi ternyata di mediknya namanya ada Berberium, ada Lokia, dan ada Dolores palsu. Nah, aku nih jadi sedikit penasaran nih, gimana sih kesan teman-teman pas research tentang atau nyari jurnal tentang hal ini gitu. Kalau Niken gimana tuh?
Oke, kalau menurut aku juga baru tahu kan ya tentang Berberium, Lokia, sama Dolores palsu. Tentunya ini sangat menarik dan menambah wawasan, seperti itu, Naya.
Iya sama juga ya ternyata. Kalau Kusya, how about you? What's your impression on this phenomenon?
Actually, I was surprised also. Actually, I never knew about Berberium and Lokia. Dolores palsu. I've never heard of any of this until we decided to do this podcast.
Yes, right. Like so many things that we didn't know, but now we know.
It's very insightful.
Oh, yes, true. I agree about that. Okay, thank you so much for the knowledge today, guys. I hope this knowledge will be useful for everyone who hear it and for all of us. Nah, that's it for today podcast. That is from me, and thank you for Kusya and Niken. I will see you guys later. Have a nice day, everyone. Bye-bye.